Father, we do thank you for your people, for your servants. Thank you for the great ministry you have committed into our hands. And thank you for the faithfulness you have granted everyone. And those of us who are at the headquarters here, the people we see, the people we don't see. And the great work you are doing through every one of us combined together. Lord, we just pray. None of us will fail in Jesus' name. And that our service will be rewarded on that final day in Jesus' name. We pray that today you'll bless your people and impact our lives in a tremendous way. And we pray, Lord, that lift us up a step higher or steps higher in Jesus' name. Bless your people. Make us a blessing to your people too. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you very much. You can sit down. As the Lord has been helping us and the work is expanding, both here in Nigeria and in Africa, as well as beyond Africa, there are some salient points we need to keep in mind. That's why I want to talk on protecting Christ's priorities in ministry. Protecting Christ's priorities in ministry. It is possible to do quite a lot and miss out on the important things, on the priorities. If you look at the church, for example, we call the church the body of Christ. If we look at our body, we have many members of the body. And none of us is going to say that the toe is as important as the head. Because you can cut off the toe and then life still remains. You can cut off even the whole hand and life still remains. You can cut off some organs of the body and life still continues. But if you cut off the head, then life is gone. That means then there are things that are very important, non-negotiables, and they are so essential that they are priorities in ministry, and we cannot do without them. As we look at the ministry then, we're looking at the priorities in Christ's own ministry, and we're seeing how to protect them. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 6, we're reading from verse 4. Acts chapter 6 verse 4, it says, but we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. The early church was confronted with some great needs in the church. And because of those great needs, then they said, it will not be right, it will not be reasonable, not proper, that we abandon this and give ourselves to this. Already you can see a comparison there. They're saying that this area of ministry is important, and we need to be able to take care of it. But we cannot leave the essential thing, the priority, and then give ourselves to just serving food. That's why they said, we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. We're looking at Acts chapter 20, verse 24. In Acts 20, verse 24, it says, but none of these things move me. Again, you'll find that Paul the Apostle was comparing some things with himself. His commitment, his consecration to the work of the Lord. He said, my life is on the line. It's like everywhere I go, they're telling me prophetically that there'll be some dangerous things awaiting me. But then he said, as I make comparison, protecting my life or protecting the essentials of ministry, I would say that none of those things move me. If we don't have that comparison in our mind or that comparison in our heart as we're ministering, we'll be putting everything the same. You know, your family is there, the church is there, and then your life is there, your profession is there. In fact, if let's say those three things, for example, you have the family, you have the church, and that is the ministry, and then you have you know, your personal life, the way you order them will show what you understand of the ministry. If you order it as number one, the ministry, number two, your family, number three, your life. What happens then is that if there's any challenge, the first thing you are going to consider is, how does this affect the church? How does this affect the ministry? After that, how does that affect my family? After that, how does that affect my life? Which means that you love the church, the ministry, more than you love your family. Which means you love your family more than yourself. Change the order. If you put yourself as number one, your family as number two, and then the ministry as number three, it means that when you are going to take decisions, the very first thing you consider, how does this affect me? My health, my happiness, my joy, and my self-esteem, my this or my that. And then after that, I'll consider how it affects my family. And of course, the last one, how it affects the church. So even though you and I may have the same three things we're thinking about, the way you order them, and the way you set them in kind of priority will mean that the decision you take will be different from mine. And so let us understand, according to what Christ has laid down for us, is the ministry first, and then the family, and then ourselves. If we look at Colossians chapter 4 verse 17. In Colossians chapter 4 verse 17, here the Apostle Paul is talking to Archippus, and he said, "And say to Archippus, take heed unto the ministry which thou hast received of the Lord." He wasn't saying, you know, take care of yourself, protect your health, and don't get into dangerous situations, and don't endanger your life, or don't, no. The priority is the ministry, and he says, take heed unto the ministry which you have received of the Lord, that thou fulfill it. So then we look at the ministry God has committed into our hands, and we're saying we need to protect those, the priorities in ministry. We're concerned, number one, foundational experiences in ministry. Foundational experiences in ministry. There are people that, you know, they just go ahead without laying any foundation, they continue with ministry, and we jump here and there, globetrot, and then, but there's no foundation. And we're told in Psalm 11 verse 3, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? A righteous minister, a righteous preacher, a righteous evangelist, but there's no foundation. And if the foundations be destroyed, what shall the righteous do? And as we look at other people that are preaching, we thank God there's that church there, that mission there. Are they not destroying the foundation? As we look at what the people are doing, the things they are preaching, no salvation again, and no holiness without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. It's like the foundation of ministry, everything is destroyed. And then what shall the righteous do? And if we now join the crowd, we join the popular preachers, and we say, well, this is how they grow, this is how they increase their numbers. And then we increase numbers too, but no more foundation. What shall the righteous do? In Luke chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 46. And why call ye me Lord, Lord, and not do the things which I say? Whosoever cometh to me and heareth my sayings and doeth them, I will show you unto whom he is like. Is like a man which built an house and digged deep and laid the foundation on a rock, and when the flood arose and the stream beat vehemently upon that house and could not shake it, for it was founded upon a rock. Verse 49, very important. But he that heareth and doeth not is like a man that without a foundation built an house. He still built a house, but no foundation. As we think of church planting and building the ministry and growing this and growing that and having this great revival, but if somebody is building without a foundation, and then it says, against which the stream did beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great, irreparable loss. And as you think about what you're doing, that's why we need to come together once in a while and evaluate what we're doing. We're, you know, doing this, and we're doing this, and we're doing that. How do we evaluate? Does it have a foundation? And when the storms come against that house and that ministry we're building, will it collapse, or will it stay? Will it stand? And what are the foundational experiences we can talk about in John chapter 3? John chapter 3, we're reading from verse 3. Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. How many places are we called to preach? We are called to add our voice to what they are saying. But you cannot talk about being born again, and you cannot emphasize being born again. We might do good, we might improve the lives of people, we might have, you know, this health care for people, and, you know, some of our women, their fellowships, they say, wasn't it a good thing? We had, you know, what a wonderful Saturday we had. And, you know, that Saturday we got all the women together, and we told them all these practical things. And the people were so excited. It's not hard. This is the kind of thing we want. But we didn't have any chance to talk about being born again. And sometimes the call us through, you know, all these political arenas and assemblies, and you know, we're to grace the occasion, we're to stay there, and there's no chance to talk about being born again. Then Christianity appears to be expanding in the country, but as expansive as Christianity is, corruption is going deeper than it was, even when there was not enough Christianity. And so the born again experience, new birth experience that should be there, is not there. And we have all these millions of people are gathering together, and Jesus said, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God, and then the rest will just be a waste of time. And let us remember that except in all the programs we're doing, all the emphasis we're laying, all the, you know, running we're doing, and all the excitement and all the money we put into what we give, except the people we're ministering to, except they are born again, it says they will not see the kingdom of God. We're looking at Matthew chapter 18, and I'm reading there from verse 3. Matthew chapter 18, we're looking at verse 3. And he said, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. That's another except. Here the Lord is saying, this is my priority. We're talking about Christ's priorities. And Jesus said his priority is conversion. It's conversion, not religion, not just that, you know, we're doing this, and, you know, we hear of this crowd and that crowd. He said, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye will not see the kingdom of God. As we think about various ministries, and, you know, we give all these wonderful reports, we say, this is great and this is good. Any change of life, any repentance, any restitution, any righteousness, or are the people just, you know, coming to the church and they just keep on living the way they were living? And then we expend a lot of money, and she will put a lot of money into these programs, but at the end of the day, it's like it was celebration, and it was great. We all came together, we sang, we rejoiced, we celebrated, and what a great opportunity. The question is, are we converted? Are those people converted? Because that is the bottom line of ministry. And then in Luke chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 1. Luke chapter 13, verse 1. You notice that these are the very words of Jesus, and these are his own priorities. In Luke chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 1. There were present at that season some that told him of the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And Jesus answering said unto them, suppose ye that these Galileans were sinners above all the Galileans because they suffer such things? I tell you nay, but except, that's the word again, except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Wouldn't it be wonderful if, you know, the ministers of the people that gather these great crowds together will tell them, well, thank God you are here, thank God you are religious, and thank God you are interested in religious and Christian things, but except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. And people think that when you think about the love of God and love of God, that you know, that's the thing. You know, you are loving, you are father, you gather people together, you are so gentle, you are so nice, and you are so meek, and you are tolerant, and you understand that people, you know, have their own idiosyncrasies, they have their own peculiarities, and they have their own shortcomings. And this is what according to shortcomings, maybe it's a lie, you know, somebody is telling a lie, that's his shortcoming. The other one is you know, into prostitution, that's his shortcoming. The other one is into this other thing, that's a shortcoming. And this is that we're calling shortcomings. The Lord said that if these works of the flesh are there, you'll not see the kingdom of God. You see, they have modified everything, that sin is no more sin, there's no white and black, there's no good or bad, everything is now colored in a way. But the Lord is still saying the same thing that he said before, except ye repent, ye shall not likewise perish. I pray we will not perish, and our people will not perish in Jesus' name. We're looking at Matthew chapter 5, Matthew chapter 5 verse 20. In Matthew chapter 5 verse 20, here are the words of Jesus, and you know the words of Jesus as eternal, as he himself was, is eternal. And so it's not like, you know, this is a new generation and this is a modern age, and because of the modern age, the words of Jesus have changed. Nothing like that. Jesus the same yesterday, today, and forever. And his word same yesterday, today, and forever. Matthew chapter 5, verse 20. He said, for I say unto you that except, that's the word again. When the Lord Jesus Christ emphasizes and says, except he be born again, except he be converted, except he repent. Now he said, except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall in no case, there's no way the Lord will adjust his own standard. You shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven, except the righteousness we have goes deep into our conscience and goes deep and gives us conviction and goes deep and is transparent, not like the superficial outward expression of righteousness by scribes and Pharisees. It says, except we have this, we cannot see the kingdom of God. You think about all the people we're ministering to, even within the church alone, not to talk of going outside to minister. You will find that sometimes now they tell us that the repentance of today is different from the repentance of the 70s. I didn't read that in the Bible. Repentance is repentance. And sometimes you find that the people that you gather around yourself, that you call them workers today, they're not even as righteous as the people that were one week converts of those days. And if our work is not going to be thrown into the dustbin, if the fire of judgment is not going to burn the work on the final day, we have to come back and sit and examine the foundation again, that accept our righteousness and accept the righteousness of the people who are working with us in the church will exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees. They will in no wise enter into the kingdom of God. And now ourselves, essentials for us in 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 5. 2 Timothy chapter 2, our reading from verse 5 there. It says, and if a man also strive for masteries, yet is he not crowned except it may not be right, but we try. Any method that will get me there, I just apply. But it says, except a preacher, except a minister, except the people who are called of God, except we strive lawfully to go. And it says, we should give the more earnest heed to the thing. Let's at any to watch television, the telly, and people fall under the anointing. They say, this is great. What else are we looking for? And yet, there is no holiness. And the Lord said, without holiness, no man shall peace with all men, and holiness with without which no man shall see the Lord. I'm reading Psalm 15. In Psalm 15, I read from verse 1. Psalm 15, looking at verse 1. Here the word of God is saying in Psalm 15, verse 1, Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? He that walketh uprightly, that walketh righteousness, and speaketh the truth in his heart. And speaketh the truth in his heart. Sometimes today you are talking to so-called a leader, might even be a regional overseer. I don't want to say state overseer or national overseer. And then you ask for something, and they tell you, and actually, this is the our hearts. We're seeing what we're saying. So as people who corrupt the word of God, they are not many. We're not as many which corrupt the word of God, but as of sincerity, but as of God, in the sight of God we speak in Christ. In the sight of God we speak in Christ. In Luke 24, while he talked with us by the way, and change, they say, don't follow our culture. We know it is wrong. It's difficult for us to come back to what it is, stay the way you are, and tell us the whole truth. Then it's encouraging when people tell you directly like that. And other people, why? When you go and stand on that word in Jesus' name. Now, verse 5, but watch thou in all things. So I'll watch. Endure affliction. Do the work of an evangelist. Make full proof of your ministry. Your ministry will be proven by God, and your ministry will be accepted, affirmed by the Lord in Jesus' name. Let's remember, Christ has priorities in ministry.